Well, good evening, brothers and sisters. My name is Annie Rose. I am the National Director of Ministerial Health for the EPC, and it is my joy to welcome you tonight to this webinar in our Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families series. Tonight, we are going to be talking about a topic that is relevant to all of us at some point in our lives, preparing your heart and your head for retirement. And I am delighted, as always, to be joined by my co-host, my good friend, Roy Yanke, Executive Director of PIR Ministries. Roy, please say hello to the people and take it away.
Hello, people. Good to have you with us this evening. So we were chatting beforehand, and I am excited about this particular episode because it's not hugely public knowledge, but a year from now, I will be retiring from my role as Executive Director. So I'm anxious to hear what Fred has to say about this. So as we begin, Fred, it's great to see you, Fred Lian, who is the chair of the Ministerial Vocation Committee for the EPC, and a pastor and a counselor and a good friend. So Fred, we're glad you're here. Thank you for joining us. I wanna just give you the opportunity to tell us a little bit about yourself in case somebody doesn't know. And your background, I shared a little bit of it, but go ahead.
Okay. Well, thank you, Roy and Annie, and for your leadership in these webinars. This has been a great blessing to the entire denomination and anyone else who might have access to to these webinars. So a little bit about my background. I am in Highlands Ranch, Colorado, which is where Cherry Hills Community Church, who hosted our 2 years ago, our GA is located. And I am married happily for 47 years in October. And my wife is a computer graphics design artist. And I am very, very blessed. Our relationship is Beauty and the Beast. And if you saw her, you would absolutely have no questions about who is who. We have a daughter who is a graduate of Denver Seminary with an MDiv, and her husband is also a graduate of Denver Seminary with an MDiv, and he's a church planner. My daughter is on full-time staff with Alpha USA, and we have 2 grandchildren with them. We're celebrating birthdays here in October, one almost 3 and one almost 1. I am also a graduate of Denver Seminary. My first degree was in marriage and family therapy, and I was a Christian therapist supervising a Christian counseling center for 6 years. During that time, I went back to Denver Seminary. I got my MDiv, and so I was kind of like a seat candidate going back and making up all the necessary requirements I needed for that MDiv. And then I was a pastor of, I was an assistant pastor. Well, as you said, I was licensed first, so I came came to the EPC when it was first formed, right there at the very beginning, and they had a licensing program. I was licensed and I was ordained in 1982 at General Assembly here in when they had it in the Denver metro area. Became an assistant pastor and then was senior pastor of Grace Point Community Church in Littleton, Colorado for 35 years before I retired. So I reached age 70. In May 2020, and retired the last Sunday, May 31st in 2020. And I'm 74 now. And I will tell you that I am, just to transition into our topic, I am not traditionally retired. I'm just doing something else. Mm. So I like to say that I have been reassigned. My daily routine has changed. My office has changed. But I believe that for most people, retirement probably has a sense of some finality. And I can tell you that I am nowhere near retirement. My wife has said in many, many times that she sees me less now that I'm retired than when I was working full time. Years ago, Ellen Goodman spoke at a seminar on the topic of leaving well. And I think her words really capture the spirit of a leader who makes a graceful exit. And this is what she said. There is a trick to the graceful exit. It begins with the vision to recognize when a job, a life stage, a relationship is over and let it go. It means leaving what's over without denying its validity or its past importance to our lives. It involves a sense of future, a belief that every exit line is an entry, that we are moving on rather than out. And so I saw, and I do see retirement as a reorientation that needs to begin prior to the actual date of what we call retirement. And my mantra, the last 5 years that I pastored and began to prepare for retirement was, I want to end well, and I want to leave well. And so prior to my retirement, because I was a counselor, I had pastored a number of other pastors who were moving into retirement and through retirement, and got to walk alongside a lot of really dedicated pastors who were grappling with the loss of their call, their vocation, their life, even their identity. So when I got to that point, I was grateful to have had that experience of listening and sharing wisdom and insight, hopefully wisdom and insight, and then applying it to my own life so that I could transition well into that retirement stage. So that's a little bit about my background there and what I'm hoping to bring and share with everyone this evening.
That's great, Fred. Thank you so much for that.
Thank
it's helpful
you.
To yes. know. Yeah, just kind of the angle that you're coming from with this, your personal experience, and especially also that experience you had counseling pastors through that transition of retirement. Sometimes, you know, some of us bristle at the idea of retirement. Some I've run across pastors who view even that term as a worldly one. They kind of bristle at the idea of retiring from the kingdom of God. What are some of the nuances that we hold in tension around this topic when we think about, you know, reaching a point in our lives when we might need to move out of a full-time compensated call?
Yeah. So even though this webinar is about retirement, the phrase I used earlier, I think, is really applicable. It's reassignment. And there's no way anyone would look at my life right now and say that I'm retired. I'm actively involved in our presbytery. I'm actively involved with the denomination. I'm still doing counseling. I'm guest preaching. I'm mentoring a couple of younger pastors as they move into their later millennial years and the struggles and the challenges and the opportunities that they're facing. So I tried to keep retirement, the word retirement, out of my vocabulary, and maybe I'm only fooling myself, but that's why I use the word reassignment. Is I'm crafting a new way of a new lens through which to look at those years after I left full time pastorate with a local church, and yeah, it is a struggle. The Book of Order makes it challenging because it says, you know, at 70, you've got to communicate 6 months before you reach 70. You've got to communicate to your presbytery, hey, I'm going to be turning 70. And the Book of Order is asking us to leave that particular vocational call. And yet it also gives the presbytery permission to extend that call year by year by year. So it doesn't have to be an end. But I think we're all aware that we need to evaluate with holy scrutiny the situation that we're in, and is it best for us to move on, and best for the church that we pastor to move on? Or does wisdom say, hey, the church wants us, and the presbytery is confirming that, so we stay where we are. In my own personal situation, I knew that I've been with the church for 35 years. They needed a new voice. I was not, I'd never preached a sermon, the same sermon twice in the 35 years I had been there. I was still active, energetic. The joy of pastoring was still really, really strong, but I knew that my voice had been diluted because I'd been there for so long, and a new voice approaching the scriptures in a new way needed to take the pulpit.
You know, in our ministry, we talk a lot about the shape of the calling, that the fact that the calling is still there, that never changes, but that the shape of it can change going forward as you enter a new chapter. And so I really like your idea of the reassignment. I think that's really important to keep in mind for those of us who are either there or anticipating this kind of a transition. And I do think, as you mentioned before, I think it's really important that we prepare our hearts and minds, right, for this, because any transition is a scary one, as a large measure of uncertainty, okay? So what are some keys that you think would be helpful as people approach this, or maybe they've already entered into it, but still need to do some fine tuning of how they approach this?
Yeah. So I believe that the number one issue that really needs to be confronted is where does an individual get their identity? And our identity is not as a pastor. It's as a child of God, one who's loved by Jesus. And about 15 years before I retired, maybe 20 years before I retired, that just shows how old I am, I was convicted one day in a devotional time that I was telling people, this is my church.
Oh.
And not with a capital C, but my identity was, yeah, the church I pastor. I had to switch the terminology rather than this is my church. Or why don't you come to my church for worship on Sunday? No, this is the church I pastor. And I had to step away and recognize that there was a little bit of pride, or maybe more than a little bit of pride, in saying my church or my congregation. And if that was taken away from me, what would I have? Who would I be? And so I went through my own counseling, my own therapy with that, because I had to recognize that maybe I was holding on too tight, not just appreciating the call that God had given me, but holding on too tight to the physical, the tangible part of that call. And I needed to step away, recognize, no, this is God's church, and he's called me to pastor this church. It's not my congregation. So I switched my whole vocabulary at that point. And I can say it was freeing. And if people criticized me, that was okay, because it wasn't about me now.
So did you have help with that? I mean, you mentioned your own counseling. Did you have somebody helping you with that?
Yeah, I have my best friend. He and I were at Denver Seminary together. And so our relationship goes back to 1975. And we have given each other permission to be brutally honest with each other. And we can say the hard things, and we receive them because we know it's in love. And so I went to him and I said, okay, here's what I'm wrestling with. And he was a pastor also, who is retired. And he said, okay, Fred, let's work through this. And we engaged in dialogue. And he pointed out that, yeah, Fred, maybe you got some pride in this. And I went, yeah, I think I do. And help me to be released from that as best I possibly could be. Mm-hmm. That didn't mean that everything was settled 100%. But there was victory and growing in being able to release that. Yeah, so he was really helpful.
Fred, tell us a little bit about, you know, what difference does it make when we do that, when we do that work with the Lord to really find our identity in being his child versus being a pastor or being a pastor's spouse? If we don't do that work ahead of time, what have you seen? How does that negatively impact us when we go through that transition, when the Lord reassigns us to a new season of ministry? What can happen if our identity really is found in our role?
That's a great question. And the counseling that I've done with other pastors, as well as what I went through myself, has demonstrated to me that the bottom line issue that comes out if we do not deal with this is that when we retire or we get out of ministry for whatever reason, the answer to who am I is not relevant. It is not there for us because we're wrapped up in, I go to the office, I meet with people, I prepare a sermon, I go to committee meetings, I'm part of the presbytery, and when that is taken away for whatever reason, we have to look to other things to fill that gap rather than already the Lord having filled that emptiness, that identity for us. And I've counseled I say this very humbly, with pastors who have wept in my office because they do not know who they are without that profession, without that vocation, not the call, but the everyday activity. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we are so caught up as a culture, and I don't know, maybe it's a human thing, in doing, and being is difficult for us, you know. And so being a child of God, mm-hmm. and having that be our root is sometimes hard to get a hold of.
So much of my counseling through the years has been helping people, just generally helping people, I understand the difference between personhood and performance. Mm. And when we get wrapped up and entangled in the performance, the personhood piece becomes diluted. And then all we're doing is competing or comparing rather than living out who God has called us to be.
Good. So, any other keys that you think are important?
Yeah, so that would be the first thing that I would really focus on. And the second element is so connected to that first piece is ensure that it is well with your soul before you are reassigned. And that's where meeting with a therapist or with a wise, good friend who will listen well, not necessarily give advice, but listen well first to all that you're experiencing emotionally, relationally, what the physical challenges might be. And then allow that person to speak the hard stuff to you. And that's humbling also. When I got together with my friend, when he was saying, "Fred, I think you've got a little bit of, I think you got some pride going on here." I could feel my defenses starting to go up, and then it was like, "Oh yeah, he's right." My defenses wouldn't be igniting unless that was a really correct statement. That was a convicting statement. And so I think, do we view this reassignment as a gift or as something we're giving up? And I think we need to look at it as a gift from God to use what he has given us in other new ways, other new challenging ways, and to trust that his leading, his providence over our lives, we can know that he'll be faithful to get us to where he wants us to be. And so I took a gap year, the year after my official ending date with Grace Point. I took a gap year where I did really no ministry. My wife and I visited churches in the Denver metro area that I always wanted to hear my fellow pastors preach. And so every Sunday we just went to a different church, and I enjoyed and soaked up the good messages and the excellent worship that we were able to have at the different churches. And I used that time to evaluate, okay, how am I doing emotionally? How am I doing relationally? How am I doing mentally? How's my attitude? And am I okay? And I was. And then after that year was over, and I was still doing stuff with the denomination, with the presbytery, good to the committee work. But other than that, I relaxed. I allowed myself to be ministered to, and that was really beneficial. And then got re-engaged in different aspects. Mm-hmm. So I think that's important to, and this is where perhaps the pro-D, Roy, could be helpful for pastors and having those trusted individuals in your lives to ensure that your soul is well. Getting that feedback from people and continuing to be in dialogue with wise friends.
Right.
Good. Well, Roy, since Fred brought up the Pro-D, why don't you give us a quick commercial and let us know how that might be a helpful tool for pastors who are thinking about reassignment in ministry.
Yeah, the Pro-D, it's similar in many ways to assessments that others have taken, DISC, strength finders, and so forth. And that's not a bad thing to re-engage with when you're on the precipice of this kind of a transition or change, simply to remind yourself of how God has wired you, how he's put you together, so that you can then have the conversation, as Fred said, with some of those trusted people to say, okay, how does who I am get reflected in this new season, this new chapter? So you're, as he said, not an end, but a gift and an entrance into a new way. And the Pro-D, it talks about, because it gives you the chance to look at the roles you've served in, especially the most recent one, you can begin to get an idea of the kinds of things that might be open to you some new avenues or expressions that look like maybe what pastoring was, but isn't pastoring. You know, some other shape to that that still expresses all of who you are, and certainly as the gifting that the Holy Spirit has given you. So it's a great tool for that, because it comes not only with the self examination, but the beginning of a conversation with someone around that can help you start to plan for the future. So we're really excited about, we've got a couple of opportunities we're building right now around this very thing with those who are approaching retirement.
Excellent. Nice. Well done, Roy. Nice and crisp.
Yeah.
And folks watching tonight, if you're interested in finding out more about the Pro-D assessment, you can contact Roy. You can go to pirministries.org and reach out, and I'm sure they'll be happy to connect with you. Also wanted to let you all know, we do have Q&A available tonight. So if you have a question for Fred or for Roy that you'd like to ask at any point, feel free to just go to that Q&A box toward the bottom of your Zoom window, and that we'll try to get to as many of those questions as we can. But back to you, Fred. You know, we're talking about, obviously, a pastor preparing for retirement, discerning the timing, discerning how we can be preparing our souls for that transition. But we all know that when a pastor retires, it affects a whole lot of other people as well. It affects the congregation. If the pastor's married, it affects their spouse. Talk to us a little bit about how we can be mindful of all the other people that are impacted by our retirement.
Yeah. So leading into that, let me just set one more little foundation here. I began communicating to the congregation and the session 5 years ahead of time that my 70 is coming. And I would communicate from the pulpit, I would communicate in classes that I taught, I would communicate in our meetings. And that also helped me prepare, because when I would hear myself saying it, it was reinforcing not only what I knew in my head, but I was hearing myself saying it. And so it became less of a threat to me, because I was the one who was communicating that, and I was the one who was taking the lead on that. So the first time the congregation heard it, there was, oh, what's going on here? And then over the years, it became more and more easy for them to hear that. And it was like, by the time it came, it was like, yeah, we're ready, because we've been told this is what's going to be happening. So I would say communicate early, and communicate often if you can, you know, as early as possible and as often as you possibly can. So then that would lead into what you were just prompting me to remember. This is really, really critical. This would be up there in the top one or two things, is that your spouse is being reassigned also. It was probably more challenging for my wife to leave the church than it was for me, because I was the one who was essentially setting the table, and we both had deep relationships within the congregation, but I was in control of those decisions to move forward. And I was able to move from the emotional part to the logical part. And it was still always in her heart. So those emotions were really, really deep. And so I would really encourage pastors with your spouse that you communicate well and often with them, also asking, what are you experiencing? What are you fearing? What holes are going to need to be filled up with other relationships, other, what needs do you have, what dreams are going to be lost in this. Have your spouse share with you what obstacles or blind spots they see you might be having to negotiate through, because they're certainly aware of the nuances of your life. And so give them permission to speak boldly to you as well. But with your spouse especially, listen well. And in my counseling background, and for those, I'm sure every pastor does this, but a person cannot listen to the logic until the emotions have been diffused. Right. And so ensure that your spouse's emotions and your emotions have been talked about and dealt with in the most appropriate and effective ways possible. And I encourage that you and your spouse speak to other pastors who have retired or been reassigned and hear their stories and what challenges they faced and maybe what they're still trying to work through. So my best friend and his wife, we meet with them almost on a monthly basis. We've been doing this since 1976, and we can just dump on them. We can vomit all our stuff on them, and they know because they've been there, and they can help lead us through those challenging times. So Annie, just to tag on to that, oftentimes we pastors or people, not just pastors, people have a difficult time identifying emotions. And so I would say, do your best to identify the emotions that you think you might experience or are experiencing, and give yourself time to grieve. If you've invested in a congregation for even just only 1 year, you've got emotional ties there. For me, it was 35 years, and so I had to step back and identify what am I going to lose? What am I going to lose? I never had to think about that before. What's going to be the hardest thing for me to give up?
Those relational pieces are so strong too. I don't want to overstate the case, but you know, when having worked in the industry as well, when you leave a job, I mean, there's loss, there's things that happen, but the relational piece typically doesn't go as deep as pastor and church kind of a relationship and all of the friendships that you build over time. You know, so that's a huge piece, I think, to really grapple with emotionally and anticipate. So,
and especially, again, because I was there pretty long, very long term, considering what the average is for pastors at churches, I would baptize and marry and bury all within that 35 years, family members. And so you're even more connected emotionally spiritually, mm-hmm. because you're streaming with all these different generations in the time that you're there. It's not just, okay, I baptized you, now I'm on to another church and I won't ever see you again. Well, I baptized you, but I also performed your wedding ceremony. And your parents, I did their memorial service, and all of that comes to the surface in those times. And that probably, let me, if I can move on to a couple other topics here, if that's okay with you.
Yeah.
At the same time, Okay, so I want to say one more thing about greeting, that everyone's greeting process is unique to them. So it might take you 5 years to work through it. It might take another pastor 6 months. Don't assume that you have to be on a particular timetable to work through whatever grieving you may be experiencing as you move on from that particular pastoral relationship. Also, identify any regrets, resentments, or relationship issues that have not been resolved. And be careful not to criticize, condemn, or complain as you move out. If you have some criticisms, don't do it in public. Do it in private with people that you can trust, who will speak into your life about those particular issues. I counseled with too many pastors who were angry that the church or the congregation didn't allow them to be or to do what they thought they needed to be or to do. And they left frustrated, disappointed, discouraged, with resentments. Obviously that's not healthy. And this will lead into another issue. When you do reach that day when you're moving on, do you stay at that church and worship, or do you move on?
Okay.
In my particular case, I knew I had to move on. It was critical for the new pastor. I wanted to be a blessing to the new pastor. He did not need me there to have people comparing him to. So I have not been. I did officiate at a memorial service there, I think once, but I asked the pastor for permission. The family had asked me, and I asked the pastor for permission, and he graciously gave me permission to do that. But we have not been back there to worship in over 4 years now. So that was yeah. I told the congregation in my final sermon there that two things. One, if you like my sermons better than his, I don't want to know about it. If you like his sermons better than you like mine, I do want to know about it.
Oh.
And then secondly, I said, I'm not your pastor any longer. I am a pastor, but I'm not your pastor any longer. Your new pastor is right here next to me. He's the one to whom you go. And then I did say one more thing. If you have any complaints, I don't want to know. But if you enjoy what he's doing, I want you to communicate that to me.
Mm-hmm.
And that was how I left. That's beautiful, Fred.
Yeah, that's good.
We need to affirm the people who God is raising up to fill the position, not to take our place. That's another thing. No one can take our place. But someone can fill the position, can fill the call. Yeah,
it's an important distinction. Mm-hmm. Well, Fred, we've had a couple questions come in from our viewers, and they both kind of fit right here where we are in the conversation. We had, and actually both of them relate to things in that fond farewell guidance that the Ministerial Vocation Committee developed a year or two ago, which you were instrumental in. And we'll include a link later to another webinar where Fred and his successor shared their story and kind of fleshed out some of that guidance on how to navigate this transition well. But one of the questions that came in from one of our viewers was this: He writes, "My church wants me to stay on during the transition to a new pastor. I've been in the community for over 30 years and they feel I can help with the transition. What are your thoughts?" So I know you just shared with us a little bit about your experience during that reassignment, moving on from Grace Point into your current season of ministry. What are your thoughts in general about the former pastor staying on through a transition and how that can be navigated with wisdom?
Right. So does that mean that the new pastor is already hired and called, and the pastor who retired is staying there with the new pastor, or they're seeking a new pastor?
That's a good question for clarification. Let me see if we can get a response on that.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, it looks like the new pastor has not been identified yet. But I think, you know, envisioning some sort of overlap there so that the pastor who will be moving on to retirement is able to help the new person find their way in. What are your thoughts about that process?
Okay. So my personal opinion, and I don't have any biblical reference to refer to, but my personal opinion is that I believe a pastor who's been there for a long time needs to move on. His or her presence needs to be out of the church. And having said that, I also recognize that that's only my opinion, and that there are places where it has been successfully handled for the pastor to stay at the church. So what I would suggest, if the latter is the way that this church is desiring to move, where the pastor stays as a new pastor moves in, then the pastor and the new pastor and the session need to sit down and define what the expectations are.
Yeah.
So here's my history. When I came to the church from which I retired, the senior pastor who had founded the church and had been there for 17 years stayed on as my associate pastor because he was 67 and a half and he had 2.5 years until retirement, and the congregation did not want him to leave even though the church was imploding. We, the pastor and I, spoke together. We hashed out what we thought would be the challenges, the obstacles, and we both agreed, well, we think we can make this work. And I was young, I was naive, I respected him greatly because of who he was as an individual, who he was as a pastor, had great respect for him. But what happened was I came in, people left because they wanted the former pastor to still be the senior pastor.
Okay.
And then people, even though I was introduced as the pastor, people still saw him as the pastor. And so they would go behind my back. And I'm not saying they did that maliciously, but they knew him. They didn't know me. So they would go and get permission from him. And unfortunately, he, for whatever reason, there was just no communication coming back from him as, here's what people are asking me, what do you think I should do? So in that first 2.5 years, it was a major challenge for both of us, for both of us. He retired. There was a great celebration for him, but my ministry probably did not occur until, and then people left when he retired because they were following him. So I see my ministry as starting maybe 5 years after he retired, where I was able to really demonstrate my leadership and affirm the call that God gave me there. And then new people started coming in and recognized me. So I'm speaking from out of my own history, which is my personal opinion, but I also understand that if the church really desires the former pastor to be there, you better write down all the expectations that you have, all the job descriptions, all the roles, all the communication structures that are going to take place, so that everyone is on the same page and there are no hidden agendas that would come out later on.
Yeah, so important. One of the things that we recommend, certainly have seen others recommend, is that if that's going to happen, that there has to be a 6 month, maybe even longer gap. You did a gap year into your retirement, but certainly a gap in that area to allow that new pastor to settle in and begin to build their own sense of ministry in that place. So, yeah. So we have a question, but I want to come back to that question, if that's okay, in a little bit. So some of the folks watching may not be at the stage of retirement yet. So they may be a ways off from that. Do you have any ideas that you could share with people that, okay, this is how you need to prepare even now for that?
Yeah, thank you. So three things I think are really, sounds like a sermon outline, doesn't it? One is, we've already spoken about this, ensure that it is well with your soul. And that's relationally, emotionally, spiritually. You know, if you're not right with God now, don't assume that when you get into reassignment that you're going to become right with God. And that make sure your devotion times now are solid, that they're not just preparation for preaching on Sunday. Ensure that your relationship with the Lord is active and dynamic and intimate and personal now, rather than just for the role of being a pastor. It has to be that individual, that there's that identity piece again. So that would be the first thing. I strove to keep my devotional time separate from my preaching preparation. Oftentimes the devotions prompted something for my preaching, but I wanted to ensure that I wasn't getting caught up in using the Bible as a textbook. I wanted it to be God speaking to me individually and personally, and then I could take those truths that he would lay on my heart and then hopefully make application in the rest of my life, not just in the pulpit. So that'd be the first thing. The second thing is establish an avocation or a hobby now. Don't wait until you retire and think, okay, now I'm going to look for something that's going to fill up some empty time that will stimulate me. Begin it early. I'm fortunate and blessed that I'm a runner, and I've been a runner for most of my life. And so for me, and I love to read. And so for me, when I moved on from Grace Point, I still had my avocation of running. I'd get out there, and I know I've shared this before, but I stole that line from Chariots of God. I feel God's pleasure when I run. And so that fills me up as an avocation. And then I love to read. So I have books that I'm engaged with. And I think that's important. Make sure you have your avocation identified and maybe already you're involved with it before you move on from your call. And then the last thing I would say is meet with a financial planner earlier than later. So there was a study that just came out. It's the Schroeder's survey that came out August 1st of this year. And I found, I'm going to quote here, that the number one regret of retirees was that they waited too long to plan for retirement. And I thought that was really significant. So there's a pastor friend of mine who is pastoring a very large congregation, about 1,000 people. A few years ago, about 5-6 years ago, he was diagnosed with prostate cancer, and he went into remission, but it's come back. So he's at the age where he can retire. He's 68 years old, but he has no retirement funds. And I know the EPC is really good about making sure that the church provides for retirement. His church did, but it was minimal. And he didn't invest more into retirement. He just thought he could keep going and going and going. And now he's at the place where he's asking the church, can you give me a retirement bonus so that I can make it through until the doctors say he may have a year of life left. And he doesn't know if he and his wife can make it a year with what they have.
Wow.
Yeah. So, you know, little questions such as, you know, what expenses did the church cover that you're going to need to cover when you retire? You know, your computer breaks. Well, you know, my church was gracious enough to provide me with a computer, a printer, books. You know, I had an expense account, study allowance. You know, what are you going to have to cover that going out with people for lunch to encourage them in ministry? Well, the church reimbursed me. I don't have that now. So what's going to have to happen? That what are you going to have to cover that the church formally covered? So those three things I think are really important. And the financial piece, the studies I've read is that most pastors do not have enough to maintain a vibrant retirement status.
Yeah. That forward thinking is so important. Yeah.
It is. Yeah. And friends, I'm going to include a whole bunch of links in our chat here in just a moment. And one of the links I'm going to include is to the EPC benefits page. It's a great blessing that we have built into our terms of call. It's teaching elders in the EPC that there has to be some provision made for retirement funds. But a lot of us haven't gone to, take the advantage of all the benefits there. Fidelity has great free financial counseling. I know usually when I hear about our benefits program, I hear the statistic that maybe half of us haven't designated who our beneficiaries are. That's a problem. So we'll definitely want to point you to the EPC benefits page to make sure you're getting full advantage of all the services there. But Fred, you know, one of the other benefits about being part of a denomination like the EPC is when it comes to things like retirement, moving on from a vocation, it's not just an individual thing. It's not just a matter between a pastor and the congregation. We have the blessing and the protection of the presbytery as well in mediating those discussions and helping with planning both on the pastor's side and on the congregation side. One of our viewers wrote in a question. He said he's just a few years from retirement, and so he can go ahead and start talking with his congregation about retirement now, but he said he's not familiar with the presbytery's involvement or process. So this is a great question for you to answer from, you know, your standpoint on the Ministerial Vocation Committee and involvement in your own presbytery. What guidance would you give a pastor in involving their presbytery and especially their ministerial committee in those discussions?
Yeah, well, really, Anna, you've just answered that. It's It's setting up a time maybe to meet with the chair of the ministerial committee or meet with the ministerial committee as a whole and communicate to them that here's your planning date for moving on from your call, from your position, and then asking for wisdom and guidance and prayer as you get into that journey. Communicating with your session is really going to be important at that time as well, which I'm assuming you are doing or have already done, and asking for their wisdom. Perhaps you have some individuals who have retired on your session, and you can communicate with them, dialogue with them about what they experienced. But So I because I sat on ministerial committee, I am on ministerial committee, that I just made it known way before the 6 months, when the mandatory 6 month time period before we reach 70 that we have to communicate with the ministerial committee. I made it known to them years before. Here's something else that I had going for me. I was in a group of pastors. There were about seven of us who met monthly for about 17 years. And they walked with me through this process as well. They affirmed me. They encouraged me. They gave me, asked me questions that prompted me to think more deeply than what I was thinking about concerning my moving on. And so that community of pastors, that ohana of pastors is really, I think, really important that you have them speaking into your life and investing into your life as well. Because the session hopefully is an encouragement, but they don't have the pastoral mindset. Other pastors do. And I'm not saying that we're a special subset of culture, but we do have different ways of looking at life, and we have different ways of communicating, unique ways, I should say, of communicating. And so that would be important to make sure that your bond with your fellow pastors is strong. And I still, even though I don't meet with this group anymore, when after I retired, I still have significant relationship with them, just because we've maintained that. Yeah. So a couple of other things I will want to mention, because I know we're the time is moving really fast here, but two other things that I think are important, and one I'm going to speak to as a therapist. If you're an extrovert or an introvert as a pastor, you're going to be dealing with these issues in different ways. So my favorite definition of the distinction between an introvert and an extrovert is this. When you hear an extrovert speaking, you're hearing what they're thinking. When you hear an introvert speak, you hear what they've concluded. So, because the introverts are processing internally, and they're coming to decisions in their head, not out of their mouth, and it's a two ways of processing information. So, for those of you who are introverts, and you're processing internally, and I'm one of those, people may not know, okay, what how are you? Because you've concluded things in your mind and you're just ready to go on to the next thing. That's why having those listening ears, those people who are gonna ask you the questions, is gonna be really important. For those who are extroverts, because you're communicating what's going on and what you're thinking, you need people to probably say, okay, time out. Let's look at some of these a little more deeply, rather than just having you speak them out. Let's stop and look at each of these aspects of what you're saying, so that we can dig a little more deeply. So that would be my encouragement from a counseling perspective. And you know, taking the Myers-Briggs or the Kiersey-Bates would be really helpful to, if you haven't identified if you're an extrovert or an introvert, that could be really helpful for you. And I don't know if the Pro-D would identify any of that, Roy.
We don't really speak to that in it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Because some of the pastors who are introverts, again, myself included, when I've asked them, so how'd you arrive at this conclusion? They paused and they said, you know, that's a really good question. I haven't thought how I process. I just process. And so drawing that out and then asking the same question with extroverts. So I hear what you're saying. How is this affecting you? Oh, I didn't think about that. I'm just talking, just speaking out stuff. So that's one thing. And then the other thing, I want to get back to expectations for just a moment. So here are some questions you can ask yourself regarding expectations concerning this retirement reassignment time. Is this a hard stop or do I look for part-time employment? After my gap year, I mentioned earlier I'm a long distance runner. So I'm working part-time 2 days a week in my local running store. And I am thriving there because I am learning a new language that I did not know existed, language of the world. And my interactions with my coworkers who have nothing to do with the church, Christianity, religion in general, is absolutely amazing. I am doing more evangelism now than I did when I was pastor in the church. It's just been a tremendous blessing. So is this a time for where work stops or ministry stops, or do you look for something else? What will my daily routine be? You know, again, you don't have to decide that right away, but there needs to be thought put into that over a period of time. Do I expect a life of leisure and relaxation? That was my parents' generation, the greatest generation. What will I want to do that I wasn't able to do while I was ministering? What will I do that is similar to what I was doing before? So that could be guest preaching. It could be sitting on committees in your presbytery or with the denomination. It could be mentoring young pastors. Do you have a bucket list of things you want to do? And I didn't have a list, but I had ideas of what I wanted to do. And then the other expectation comes in with the church that you are moving on from. Okay, so bear with me on this one. Do I expect the church to celebrate me when I retire? I retired just as COVID began. May of 2020. We weren't meeting in person. Well, people were meeting in person. They weren't supposed to be, but they came anyway. But what is your expectation of what the church should do for you when you retire? And if so, what kind of celebration do you expect? Is it going to be a party? Should they give you a check as a bonus, thank you gift? What do you expect? Do I expect to maintain relationships with the congregation? So there were several couples that have been in our lives for decades, and we maintain relationships with them ever since I retired, but we don't talk about the church. I made that my rule. Unless it's something that great that's going on, I don't want to know what you're frustrated with or what the problems are. Just tell me the good stuff. So we maintain our relationships with them that way. And then the last thing I would say is, and I'll reinforce this because I've said it before, give yourself time. Grieve, to evaluate, to reflect, to be in relationship with someone who's going to hold you accountable for the new life stage that you're in.
I'd like you to, go ahead, Roy.
So it's okay. No, I just want to affirm the couple times you've said this, because it's so very helpful, even as I'm looking forward to my succession plan and transition out, is to hear only the things that you can celebrate, to hear the good things and be able to join in that, in what God is doing, because it, in my mind, it reinforces the idea that this is not my thing. This is God's thing that's going on. And I can rejoice in that and give thanks for that. And that's really not how we typically go about it. So that was that. I love that. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah. This does not sound humble, but I think it's really important. Every opportunity I have to communicate positively about the new pastor, I take that opportunity and I build on it. I think I can honestly say no one has heard me say anything negative about the new pastor.
Yeah. That's wonderful. That's such a gift to the church.
Yep.
Well, Fred, I have a couple follow-up questions here before we move toward wrapping up for tonight. The first, I want to press in a little bit about grief. You've mentioned that, you know, we will go through a grieving process, that grief manifests differently for different people. If you could, you know, especially with your background in counseling, give us just a quick sketch of some of the different flavors of grief, because I think one of the things that sometimes catches us off guard is we experience different things emotionally, and it may take us a while to realize that it's actually grief rearing its head. So, you know, just kind of map out for us the spectrum of different ways we might experience grief when we have moved into a new season.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. A challenging question. Very challenging question. you know, there are going to be some pastors who will not experience grief. For some, it may be a relief to be out of the pressure cooker. But there is a grief there because it might be expressed in anger. Why were things not better for me? So the grief itself may not be the sense of loss. The grief itself may be the anger that things weren't as hoped for, as expected, as dreamed about, as it's compared to other pastors that I was with, or other churches that I saw that were thriving. So that grief may not be tears of loss, but anger and frustration. So that's one part of it.
Mm-hmm.
The other part is not not experiencing that loss or that grief right away. It may come 6 months down the road. It may come a year down the road. And as you said, and I said earlier also, is that there's no timeline on that grief. So the best way to identify that is the hard work of what emotion, not just what feelings, what emotions am I exhibiting, am I expressing? Because it may come out, that grief may come out in being short with someone, being critical, expressing frustration about something that normally wouldn't frustrate you. It may come out in other varieties of your expression of life.
Yes. That's so helpful, Fred. I really appreciate, and I'm happy to hear more if you have more thoughts, but that's what I was hoping to hear you tease out a little, because I think sometimes we hear the word grief and we just think sadness, but for some of us, grief comes out as crankiness or critical spirit. So I really appreciate you teasing that out a little bit.
And some pastors, because we have done so many memorial services in our lifetime, we've dealt with grief and loss by suppressing it. And it may not, then it may surface a lot later after that reassignment time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So important to have these kinds of conversations because of those very things, you know, that we don't even know are lurking right behind what we are experiencing. Yep. So I think I have another question, but we don't have time for it. But I would love for us to come back at some point, because I think it'd be helpful. I think it'd be great to get your perspective on, without going into detail, the conversations you and your wife had around the transition, and, you know, unpacking a little bit more about, you know, you had set the table and the relational piece was probably more existential for her. Mm-hmm. We have somebody that asked this question. I think it's a good one too. If someone is thinking about retiring before the official age of 70, you know, could it be harder to talk about that with the church and discuss that in advance? Do you think there are any pitfalls or any things that you might have that, you know, they should be aware of?
Well, the first thing that comes in my mind is, without any reflection on this, is no, because retirement is retirement. It would be communicating, here are the reasons I believe God has led me to this decision. And communicating, say with the congregation, it's not you. This is, hopefully it isn't them, but this is where God is leading me right now. And I'm at peace in my heart with this. And I want to thank you for your ministry to me as I move and transition out of this call. Yeah.
Good.
So I think it's the way it's communicated to the individuals who you're ministering to that is really most important. But if God's laying this on your heart, you're like, hey, I'm moving you on. And if they can't accept you being obedient to God, then that's their problem, not yours.
Okay. Yeah, good.
That's yeah. Good. And I would just add to that an encouragement to the pastors out there. You know, if you are feeling that inward nudge from the Holy Spirit that maybe the time is coming for a transition, pay attention to it. You know, pay attention. Lord willing, you've got those trusted counselors in your life that you can trust, that you can speak with, Hopefully you can have a relationship of trust with your ministerial committee so that they can be a part of that processing as well and discernment. But don't ignore when the Lord is moving you on. He's got something else for you. And so we can listen and pay attention and move forward in faith. So, well, Fred, we've been talking tonight about preparation, preparing our hearts and our heads. And yet I'm sure there are some who are either watching tonight or will be viewing this in the future who have already passed this threshold. They've already gone into reassignment. They're in a new season of life and ministry, and maybe they're struggling a little bit. Maybe they didn't have a wise counselor in their life to help them prepare well. What can they do now to get to a healthier place if they realize that they're struggling a bit, if they realize the grief is maybe a bit heavier than what they were expecting? What are some steps that they can take to move toward a healthier place?
Great question. So identifying a wise confidant with whom you can communicate those emotions and that mindset, whether it's a professional therapist or not, but someone that you deeply trust, I think engaging with that person would really be important. In terms of, I would also say, write down all the emotions that you're experiencing and the reasons that you believe you're experiencing those emotions. And I keep using the word emotion. I don't use the word feeling because, I'm sorry, I'm going off on a tangent, but in our culture, we've used the word feeling in the wrong way. You know, we will say things like, well, I feel like going to the movies, and we think we're expressing an emotion. No, we made a decision. We were voicing an opinion. I feel happy about going to the movies. Now I've got an emotion in there. So I'm wanting people to not just think about feelings, but to really identify what is the emotion that I'm experiencing right now, and write that down. And then what is the possible reason that this emotion is being experienced by me? And I think that would be clarifying. And then if someone wants, I would be available to talk with you and listen well and be available. Yeah. There are, in terms of books that might be available, I have not found a really good book on retirement from a Christian perspective. So there, yeah.
Sounds like you need to write it, Fred.
Yeah.
There you go.
There's my bucket list, right? So I would really encourage not to hold it, but to get it out from you. Hear yourself saying these things, because then it has less control over you when you can hear yourself saying, I'm really frustrated because I don't know what I'm going to do with my days. And when you can get that out there, it has less manipulation of your heart and your mind. That's why we have counselors, because they should be listening for those things.
Yeah. Good.
That's right. Well, Fred, I am so grateful for this time that we've had with you tonight. So thankful for your willingness to share from your own experience and the wisdom the Lord has given you. And I'm also super grateful that you're willing to receive contact from anybody who might reach out. So viewers, we've included Fred's email address there in the chat. If you would like to reach out to him directly, very, very generous offer. He just continues to pastor, no matter whatever else he's doing, continues to care for the souls that the Lord entrusts to him. Roy, also just so grateful again for your partnership in this series and for PIR and the partnership you have with the EPC. And thank you for being here tonight and being so instrumental in this conversation.
And my pleasure. To you, Annie, as well.
Yes, absolutely. Wow. Yeah.
Thank you both.
Yeah.
Well, friends, we wanted to remind you we've got another upcoming webinar in this series on Monday, September 23rd. We're going to be talking about the fully human pastor, picking up on some themes that Fred brought up early in our discussion tonight about having the source of our identity being secure as children of God. So please plan to join us on September 23rd. We're going to be joined that evening by Mike Anderson and by Larry Hackman. It's going to be a great conversation. Mm-hmm. I've included the link to register there in our chat, so we hope to see you there. And as we go out tonight, let me just close us in prayer. So please join me. Lord Jesus, we are so thankful that you are the foundation. You are the cornerstone. You are the head of the body, the church. You are the bridegroom we are waiting for. You are before all things, Lord, and in you all things hold together, even our very identities. We thank you for your love. Thank you for the gift of calling, that you have created each one of us in your image to do good works that you prepared ahead of time to be our way of life. And Lord, we're grateful that those good works continue even beyond what we call retirement, that in every stage and season of life, there are things that you put in our path, opportunities, relationships, where we can display your goodness, where we can carry forward your mission. I thank you, Lord, for my brothers and sisters who are watching tonight, and I pray your blessing on them as they discern your direction and your call. I thank you for Fred, Lord. Thank you for the faithful servant he is and all the ways that he influences our denomination for good, and just has been instrumental for decades in shaping healthy leaders for your church. I thank you for my brother Roy, for all of the good work he does through PIR. And God, we pray that as we seek to follow you and serve you humbly and diligently, we pray that you would be glorified, that your name would be praised and lifted up in every square inch of the universe. And we thank you that we get to have a part in it. So thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. We praise you for this time together tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Fred.
All right.
Yeah. Shalom, you all.
Shalom.
Shalom. Good night, everybody.
Bye-bye.